National has unveiled its long-awaited tax plan, promising almost $15 billion in cuts, targeted predominantly at what it calls the squeezed middle. Nicola Willis is National's finance spokesperson and is with us this morning. Kia ora, good morning.
Kia ora, good morning.
What are you trying to achieve with this?
We're trying to make sure that New Zealanders who are struggling through a cost of living crisis have the opportunity to have a bit more income in their pay every fortnight so that they can keep up with what have been rapidly rising costs. We want them to keep more of what they earn, to know that they can get ahead and to have the assurance that when they work hard, the government will back them.
Just because I know so many people are going to be tuning in this morning, let's start with some economic theory. Would you agree that introducing new money into an economy without increasing the supply of goods would be inflationary?
It depends how you do it.
If you introduce new money from outside an economy into an economy without increasing the supply of goods, that's a simple equation.
So I think what you're asking me about is the foreign buyers tax, which we're proposing to put on. And our view on that tax is that it will have a couple of impacts. One is it will encourage more people to come to New Zealand and invest in our businesses, productive growth, entrepreneurs who want some capital to innovate with. The other effect that it will have is it will bring some revenue into New Zealand that will help fund our tax reduction plan.
Right.
Now, you have to look at our tax reduction plan as a whole.
Because
in its first year, you will be aware, it saves more money than it spends.
So $740 million in new money you are essentially introducing to the economy through that foreign buyers ban or the tax on foreign buyers. That is money that is coming from outside of our economy without increasing the supply of goods within our economy, which is, by its definition, inflationary.
Well, at the same time as we're doing that, we're reprioritising money away from wasteful backroom bureaucracy. We are also ensuring that money that's currently being spent on contractors and consultants...
No, this is new money, though. This is no different to if the government just decided to borrow more. It has exactly the same inflationary impact. But we're talking about introducing new money to an otherwise confined economy. This is inflationary.
Well, the effects of that could be a couple of fold. One, you may see that some of that money ends up being used by New Zealanders to save more, to reduce their debt by paying off their mortgages faster, in which case it's not going to go straight into cycle in the economy.
Right, they may choose to save. They may also choose to spend, though, right?
But if they choose to save, that will mean that money is not in circulation in the
economy. So if New Zealanders all choose not to spend the money, then it won't be inflationary.
The second thing that could happen,
Jack... That's the theory, though, right?
If New Zealanders choose
to save, then it won't be inflationary. I want to talk more about this foreign buyers ban, because it is absolutely critical to the overall funding of your tax policy. So $740 million a year on average it's going to bring in. How exactly did you reach that figure?
So what we did was we looked at house purchases prior to the foreign buyer ban being brought in, and we looked at the pattern of purchases. Then we scrolled forward and we thought, well, given house prices have now gone up, given the pattern of where those homes were bought in the past, i.e. they tend to be bought in those areas with luxury homes, you know, the Coromandel, the Bay of Islands, Queenstown.
They're nice homes.
And given the luxury type of homes and the prices they will be paying and the effect that will be had once you bring off a ban, at the same time as you're getting rid of the effective capital gains tax in the form of the bright line test, what sort of pattern of purchase can we expect and what revenue can we expect? And we're comfortable that our assumptions are cautious.
Right.
We had them checked by an external advisor who agrees with us that they are reasonable assumptions, and we're confident in our costings.
Okay, so if you have that big model, that grand model, you'll still get two numbers at the end, right? A median house price and a total number of house sales you're forecasting.
Mm-hmm.
So what are those numbers?
And those numbers will vary depending on what exactly happens.
Well, no, to get $740 million, you need to have a median price, an average house price, and a total number of houses.
Yes, that's right.
So what is it?
Well, those numbers will vary, but we have an estimate in our model for those numbers.
And so what is the estimate in your model?
The estimate in our model is that the average price will be more than 2 million and that we will sell fewer than 2,000 homes. I want to just focus in here.
No. So the average price is going to be $2 million.
More than 2 million.
So what is the average price going to be?
It's going to be more than $2 million.
What is the average price going to be?
Well, it will depend on which homes sell, and real estate agents
are saying... So this is an average. No. This is why we have an average. So what is the median price across all of those homes you're expecting to sell? What is the median price, the average price?
It will depend on exactly what happens, but
Nicola,
it will be about two.
Do you want to be the finance minister?
I do.
You have to give us the average. It doesn't change. The average doesn't change.
The average in
according
our,
to your
the average
model,
in our
the
model
average?
In its first year is $2.9 million. But my point is a really good one, Jack, and I want you to listen to it.
No. I want to dig into these numbers, and then we'll give you an opportunity to do that. I'll make sure you have an opportunity. So $2.9 million. Okay. So how many houses will you need to sell at $2.9 million?
Fewer than 2,000. That's right.
How many houses were sold to foreign buyers in 2018?
My point that I was trying to make earlier, and I think it's really important your listeners hear it, is this. You cannot compare what's going to happen exactly in our market today with 2018 or even with now, because two big changes have happened. The first is that Labor has introduced a bright line test, which means that many people who own a second property in places like Queenstown or the Coromandel have been put off selling that home. Mm. So that has potentially depressed the market for those luxury homes. Mm. The second thing that's happened is that house prices have increased significantly since when the foreign buyer was last on. And the third thing that's happened is that we think that the proportion of people who will want to come and purchase is going to recover as soon as you lift that ban.
I'm just doing the maths, okay? Yeah. So in 2018, before the foreign buyer ban was lifted, how many purchases as a percentage of overall purchases in New Zealand did foreign buyers represent?
I don't have that number right
okay,
now.
Okay, I do. It's 3%, right? So if the average price for houses that you're going to sell is going to be 2.9, I've rounded up to $3 million, right? Mm-hmm. So if the average price is $3 million, even though in 2018 they were just 3% of buyers, they would have to represent 28% of buyers.
Well, here's,
in that top tier.
No.
The point is that for your numbers to work, you have to increase the number of foreign buyers almost tenfold from 2018 before that ban was lifted. That's fantastical.
No, Jack, that is not the case. What actually needs to happen is that when we lift the ban, we will see foreign buyers entering the market. We will see probably much more transactions in that part of the market, in that luxury end of the market. Mm. The next thing that will happen is that it won't just be houses selling at that price point. There will also be houses selling at much higher price points. Mm. We're talking $10 million homes,
$20 million homes. $20 million homes. So what was the most expensive house sold in New Zealand last year?
This is the point.
What was the most expensive house last year?
I'm not going to compare the market last year with a market that doesn't have a foreign buyer.
First part of 2022 was absolutely gangbusters. So what was the most expensive house sold in New Zealand last year?
The other thing that's important to remember is that last year there was a bright line test applied over a 10-year period, which meant that anyone who had bought their house in the past couple of years knew that if they then sold it, they would have to pay a full capital gains tax on it. So it's not fair to look at that market and say it's indicative
houses,
of what's
right?
going to happen going forward.
You're talking about $20 million houses,
in some
right?
cases, yes.
Okay, well, good news, I've got a photo here of a $20 million house. That was the most expensive house sold in New Zealand last year, Paratai Drive in Demuera. And just check out the interior. Lovely, unspoiled views of the Hauraki Gulf. So that was the most expensive house sold in New Zealand last year. $20 million that cost. If you sold 50 mansions for $20 million, 50 of those, okay? So not one like we did last year. If you sold 50 of those, and then you got your $10 million mansions as well, and you sold 50 of those, you would still be more than $500 million short of your projection.
But that's over a four-year period.
No, that's for 1 year. That's for 1 year. We can do the maths right now if
Jack,
you want to do them.
Jack.
No. This is absolutely critical to your funding.
Yes, and we are very confident in our costings because we think that there will be hundreds of transactions.
Right.
We think that there will be people who want to purchase these properties. Mm. We believe that we will get the tax revenue from them. And we think that our estimates are cautious, they are conservative.
Okay.
They're based on the pattern of purchases that have happened previously,
In the interest of transparency and economic credibility, as the person who wants to be the next finance minister, will you commit to releasing your full model?
We have already released
the basis
of our costings.
The model. Will you release the full model that gave you the costings, including that 2.9 median figure for the average house price you're going to sell to foreign buyers? Will you commit to releasing that model?
I don't think it's necessary because I've released my assumptions. I've made it
clear
that they've been checked.
In the interest of transparency and as a representative of the party that sells itself on its economic credentials, will you release that model?
I simply don't think it's necessary, Jack.
Wow. Okay, let's talk about tax and international treaties. You say in the document that you have sought legal advice on FTAs.
Yes.
Did you seek advice on tax treaties as well?
We have subsequently talked to people about tax treaties because the view on tax treaties is that it does depend on whether or not the foreign buyer charge is seen as a tax or not, and it also depends on the country that you're dealing with. So in the case that David Parker desperately brought up during the week, we think he's completely wrong for two reasons. One, at the moment, Chinese buyers are totally banned from purchasing houses in New Zealand. And what we're creating is some conditions under which they could buy in certain cases if properties are worth more than $2 million.
But you'll tax them,
and,
right?
Yes, that's right. Mm. We will make them pay a very significant charge at point of purchase for permission to buy a home. So, but the second thing is this. This week, the government introduced a bill which would have unilateral tax treatment of digital services. And they did that because countries do, from time to time, do that. And we reserve the right as New Zealand to do that in terms of our tax treatment. Many other countries around the world tax foreign property. There's no reason for foreign purchases of property. And there's no reason New Zealand shouldn't too.
Except for the non-discrimination provision that is present in many of our tax treaties with countries. So in our tax treaty with China, it says this: it's not possible for residents of China to be subject to any taxation which is more burdensome than the taxation of New Zealand. And there is a distinct difference between tax treaties and the FTAs, which you sought advice on when you were developing this policy. So we've been speaking with Professor Craig Aleph from Auckland University. He's a professor of taxation and the director of the New Zealand Centre for Law and Business, a former tax partner at KPMG and Chapman Tripp. And he has real concerns about the policy. This is what he says: about half of New Zealand's tax treaties have a non-discrimination clause, including Australia, Canada, China, Hong Kong, India, Japan, Mexico, the US and the UK. That non-discrimination clause would mean you cannot introduce a foreign buyer's tax. I would expect a significant possibility of a challenge by the taxpayers, i.e. the foreign buyers. There would also be a significant political and legal risk with our treaty partners. The treaty partners could terminate the double tax treaty or negate various parts of the agreement. There are many other political consequences, such as the termination of agreements like FTAs for such a serious breach of international law. Now, that's not just some guy. That is the director of the New Zealand Centre for Law and Business, a professor of taxation at Auckland University. What does he get wrong?
Well, there are other views which interpret those tax treaties differently. There's clear evidence that many of the countries he's listed already do these charges themselves. Mm. And finally, and I think this is really important, let's get in the real world. Do you really think that China is going to have a diplomatic incident with New Zealand because we say, you know how we banned people from your country from buying houses altogether? Mm. Well, now we're going to let them, but the condition is they have to pay a charge. Actually, that's a step forward in terms of their rights with regard to New Zealand, not a step backwards. And so we are confident that this can be diplomatically managed.
Right, so you think this is going to require diplomatic management?
No, I do not think that this is going to trigger the kinds of legal disputes that your professor has referred to.
What modelling have you done on the pressure that the foreign buyer allowance will put on houses in the $1.7 to $2 million category?
Well, what we wanted to do was set a floor so that we could be confident that foreign buyers weren't competing with New Zealanders in either the first home buyer market or the median part of the market. Now, bearing in mind the average house price in New Zealand is less than $1 million. So what you're asking me to compare is, well, if prices at Gucci go up, is that going to affect prices at Glassons? And essentially, we don't think it will.
Right, you don't think it will. Have you modelled it, was my question.
No, we have not modelled that.
Haven't modelled it. So there is, I mean, if we're to once again reflect on economic theory, there's every reason to think that if you were seeking to sell a house for $1.7 million, which would be like a three-bedroom house in Mount Albert, Gucci, that you might be incentivised to increase the price so that you could attract foreign buyers, if indeed foreign buyers are able to purchase.
Well, look, I think that is going to highly depend on what foreign buyers want to buy. And what evidence tells us from the past, when we didn't ban foreign buyers, was that they tend to want to buy luxury properties, not typical family homes. Mm. They typically want to buy in areas that are particularly distinctive, whether that's the Bay of Islands, the Coromandel, Queenstown. And so we don't think that it's going to have a massive effect on properties under $2 million.
If it comes to pass that we can't introduce this tax on buyers from China, the US, the UK, Japan, Mexico, those other countries. Do you accept it will be impossible to reach that $740 million?
I think we're going to be able to sell these properties, and I think we're going to be able to generate this revenue. And I tell you what else. Mm. We have put together our tax plan very cautiously. Mm. In fact, the estimates we've done for how much the tax indexing will cost, they're less than even the CTU say. And last time I checked, they were doing attack ads about us.
And when we look at the cost of the family boost policy,
our external reviewers said, hang on, we think it'll cost less. We said, we're going to go with the cautious estimate.
But you won't release
when we look at
this
the price of the climate dividend. Well, the ETS price has gone up since we did the modelling.
So talk to us about your casino. Tax offshore casino operators, online gambling. So you reckon you'll bring in about $180 million a year. And considering that policy, have you or your colleagues met with representatives of Sky City or the gambling industry in New
Zealand? People in our team have spoken with people from Sky City.
So you've been lobbied?
Yes. Right. Yes, because you can imagine the domestic gambling industry look at the Wild West, the unregulated world of online gambling, and they say, hey, is it reasonable that we have a harm minimisation framework here in New Zealand designed to put controls and constraints on gambling, and we apply that to New Zealand firms but not to offshore? Mm. And I look at that from a position of fairness and what's right. And from a policy perspective, I don't think it's right to allow that Wild West to go on.
Have you heard of VPNs?
I have.
How do they work?
I was informed about them during the week. They allowed you to sidestep geo-blocks.
Mm. So what's to stop anyone who wants to access international online gambling institutions that aren't complying with New Zealand law from New Zealand?
Well, I just think really human nature is such that people want to do things in a way that's convenient. And at the
VPNs are extraordinarily convenient. Well, you literally hit a button. You just do that. Click it. Maybe you pay $30 a month for a subscription.
And there will be ways of pursuing that because the big Because the big international providers know that under a regime where they have to register as a company in New Zealand, comply with our company tax requirements, our GST requirements, our gambling tax requirements, that anything they're doing to promote or market themselves as something that can avoid tax is going to be very problematic.
Right,
so we don't see that as being a way for anyone to get a decent market share in New Zealand, and we think that that's something that can be followed up on. You had no advice on
the implementation of VPNs when you developed this policy either, did you?
Well, look, there are a number of policy areas in New Zealand where people practically could use a VPN, but in reality don't.
Like what?
Well, if you look at people downloading things from offshore, actually most people are happy to pay a Netflix subscription.
Yeah, but Netflix costs money overseas as well.
Yes, but my point, Jack, is that while there are ways that people can evade charges, you find that actually most people don't want to break the law. And what you're saying to me is anyone who's online gambling now in future will be prepared to break the law by avoiding our regulatory regime. And I think better of New Zealanders than that. I think actually most people will want to comply and use it legal channels.
I know we're going to be speaking again before the election. We've only talked a little bit about inflation. We haven't talked at all about economic growth, so that will be for next time, and I look forward to that. But I want to finish again by thinking about credibility. So what happens if you fall short on these revenue projections? You say that it's totally costed, that you can ring fence this tax policy, $15 billion in, $15 billion distributed. What happens if you don't make that money? Because you can't put the proverbial genie or tax cuts back in the bottle.
Well, that's right. We're making a commitment to New Zealanders. I will be looking at them in the eye during this election campaign and saying, you can guarantee this tax relief which National is campaigning on. And there's a couple of things that give me comfort about that commitment. The first is, as I said, we've been very cautious in the way we've put together our estimates. The second is this. We have not yet put forward our full fiscal plan, but we have been very cautious about the additional spending promises we are making in this campaign, unlike our counterparts, the Labour Party, who have already made significant announcements which will require a lot more borrowing.
No. Please answer that question. What do you do if your revenue falls short of your projections?
I don't think it will. And I know you don't think it will.
What do you do if it does?
I don't think it will. I'm not prepared to address a false hypothetical.
All right. We look forward to speaking with you again before the election.